We're talking about, are you well anchored? So, several things I want you to, verse 22. I love verse 22. Look at it. Verse 22. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. Now, your destiny, you might want to write this down somewhere. Your destiny is greater than your storm.
Amen.
That's why it's so important. There's hardly a time that I teach you that I do not talk about your destiny. There's hardly a time that I do not remind you that you're on divine assignment. There's hardly a time that I don't remind you about purpose and tell you that you are here because there's a purpose in your life. And we even talked last week how sad and how awful it was. One of the saddest things that take place is that you do not know, you live your life and don't know your purpose and don't know why you're here. So it's very important. You say, but I don't know. Seek the Lord. And of course, everybody's here to be an ambassador for the Lord. Everyone's here to be a shining light in the darkness. So you don't have to walk around saying, I don't know, I don't know. I know if you belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, I just gave you two outstanding things. To get somebody to know the Lord and to show somebody who God Almighty is. That's your purpose. The whole reason you're sent here. To come to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ and let Him light your fire. So that somebody, somewhere, who's walking in darkness will see Jesus and come out of the darkness. That's your purpose. And then, of course, God gives divine assignments to people to do certain things. So your destiny is greater than your storm. Now, the key to surviving the storm is being anchored. So, you know, you need to write that somewhere. The key is being anchored. Now, I got all hung up on anchors, so I did a study on anchors. And it's quite amazing if you ever take time to do it. It's fascinating. So let me tell you a few little things that you already know. Anchors hold you steady in a storm, particularly if you got four. But they represent safety, security, stability, that you're grounded. And they give you something that you can hold on to, the values, if you take it personal, the values in your life. And you will not be moved away from what you believe. Now, all of us need that. Because all have great belief systems until the storms come. And so we need to be anchored in our belief system. We need to be anchored to what God is telling us. Anchors also keep you upright and keep you from drifting. And, you know, Hebrews talks about drifting. We do not want to drift away from the things of God. And that's what the devil does. Just inch by inch, you find yourself drifting. You may just drift a little bit, but if you don't have an anchor, you go drift far too far away, and you go find yourself totally out of contact or out of contact with anyone or anything. So the anchor will hold you in the storm. And then it's a stabilizer for you. And the anchor is a Victorian symbol used for hope. And early Christians used the anchor as a disguised cross and a marker to guide the way to secret meetings. And it was a key Christian symbol then part of the Roman persecution. So anchors are very important in our lives. And they represent Christ. They keep you on the right path. So who is our anchor? The Lord Jesus Christ. Four anchors they let go of here. To keep them from drifting. God doesn't want you to go through the storm. He wants you to grow in the storm. I mean, He wants you to go through it, not just through it, but He wants you to grow in the midst of it. So again, weathering storms will make you stronger. Three times Paul instructed you, three things Paul instructed you to go through when you go through a storm. One, brace up the ship. That's in verse 17. That's when they put the rope around it. Brace up the ship. And he used several things. Brace your mind with the word of God. In 1 Peter 2, actually I went to 2:24, but the whole chapter of 1 Peter chapter 2 tells you about getting your life together and letting go of things and getting your life totally in order. And of course you know 1 Peter 2:24. You know, if you don't, you ought to know what it means. He personally, it says it in the Living Bible, he personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so we could be dead to sin. Now, that's an important thing. You can be dead to sin. So none of us say, I couldn't help it, I couldn't help it, I couldn't help it. We say that. But the Bible says, no, that God has made it so that we are dead to sin. If we will press into him, that's what he's done. And of course, by the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. Those are foundational truths that we need to hold on. Then we need to declare, and when you brace up the boat, we need to declare the truth of God's word in your circumstances, so no matter what's happening. Job made a statement in Job 8:7. He says, "And though you started with little, you will end with much." Hallelujah. Can you not grab hold of that? Yes. Well, it should have been an amen there. Hallelujah. And then in Jeremiah, you know Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans of good, not evil, to give you a future and a hope." That's how God sees you. People say, "Well, God may be against me." You remember they used to sing about God's against you, or God's going to get you for that, and God's going to get you for that. God's not going to get you for that. That's no good. God is trying to pull you to himself. He's made a way for you to get out of that, whatever that is. God's on your side. He's out to help you accomplish and overcome anything. And your calling will be brutal on your selfishness. How many of you already figured that out? If you hadn't, your day's coming. And you have to brace yourself up. You have to learn to quote the scriptures unto God. I mean, you just have to. And you have to remember that love never fails. Look at your neighbor and say, "Love never fails." And when your month is longer than your money, anybody ever had that? There's a place that can help you through it all. It's called Malachi. And when you go to Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, it'll help you with that particular thing. And it says this, you better listen to it. I've been teaching this for years and we don't seem to get it too good. "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in. Try it. Put me to the test." That's the only place where God said, "Put me to the test." Put me to the test. Give your tithes and see if I won't come through. He'll make your month as long as your money, or your money as long as your month. Hallelujah. He'll make it work out. You can't figure that, I guarantee you. But he will make it work out. And some of you are afraid to even try it. I'm telling you, you're missing blessings. God can't pour out a blessing on you if you don't open the window. You got to open the window. And the tithe opens the window. So you need to be involved in that. I'm telling you, maybe you didn't know, but Abram did not become Abraham at all until he paid his tithe to Melchizedek. Hello. The Lord is El Shaddai, not El Cheapo. So you need to grab hold of those things. Number one, brace up the ship. Number two, cheer up. You and I need to cheer up. Verse 22, when he makes it very clear for us, you know, everything's going to be all right, is what he's basically saying. Verse 22, take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. He's actually saying, you know, it could be much worse. I'm actually giving you a word here that says, you're not going to die. There's going to be trouble, but you're going to make it through it. And we're saying the same thing. Hey, it's not going to get us. Amen. Look at your neighbors. It's not going to get you. It's not going to get you. We curse diseases. Yes. We curse sickness. Yes. We curse all the things that the enemy is doing. And we stand strong with each other. Amen. Going to live and not die. We're going to sail through this storm. Amen. Faith overcomes the world. Demons can't stop you. You know, people are always talking about all the demons and stuff, and I said, I don't even want to talk about it. I'm going to give them my time. Hallelujah. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. They are defeated. I read the book. They are defeated. The blood of Jesus Christ is greater than any demonic force. Now, I'm not saying that they're not demons. Of course there are. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that demons don't use people. Of course he does. He doesn't have anything else to use but people. Of course he does. But I'm here to tell you that my God, your God, is bigger than any little imp, wimp, or anything else. My God is bigger than the forces of hell. Do you understand? And we break their power and stomp their head in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. You have an anchor that's stronger than lies. Be of good cheer. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. And God is leading you to a perpetual victory. That's why the Lord said, grow up the body of Christ and teach them victory, is what he said. Look at your neighbor, he said, victory.
Victory.
We don't believe in defeat.
No.
Say, I will not,
be defeated.
Say it again, I will not,
be defeated.
Hell, listen to us.
Hell, listen to us.
We will not,
be defeated.
Heaven, listen up.
We are your children.
We stand on your name.
We
proclaim your blood is greater than any and everything.
We will not
be defeated
because our God
has already won the battle. And we are shouting the victory. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. So, you know, then we want to brace the ship. We want to cheer up. Now we want to lighten up. Lighten the load. Storms will show you the extra stuff you've taken on that really don't matter. How many of you figured that out? I mean, you got junk everywhere, and it don't matter. The depression that's dragging you down, that goes overboard. Fear goes overboard. The baggage of unforgiveness goes overboard. Because that excess, the baggage of selfishness goes overboard. Because all that junk will sink your ship. You will not be able to rise above it if you're carrying all this stuff. You know, everything I said, you already know that God has answered everything about this. I didn't have to name it. You know what they are. And you know what the baggage is in your life. You know what it is. You know, you get to sailing and it slaps you down, hallelujah. I mean, you got to get above it. In Hebrews 12, I'm going to Hebrews 12. I want you to see this. We're talking about lightning things now. In Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, they're all around us, those who have conquered, those who've overcome, those who've walked through. So it says here, there's a huge crowd of witnesses. Yeah, they're cheering us on. It says, let us strip off every weight that slows us down.
Yes.
Especially sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding it's shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. He did it. I mean, he didn't get hung up in what was in. He looked beyond the cross. He looked at why the reason he came. He looked at what he was going to conquer. He looked at what he had, that the Lord was going to help him gain. You need to look at what you're gaining. The boat doesn't stay upright on its own in the storm, no matter how big it is. It's the anchor that keeps it upright and enables it to withstand the storm. That ability in the anchor, and Jesus is your anchor. Hallelujah. Brace up, cheer up, lighten up. Let's say it together. Brace up,
brace up.
Cheer up,
cheer up.
Lighten up.
Lighten up.
Throw off every bit of luggage that weighs you down, and then you just keep right on going. You won't stand if you don't get anchored.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.
There's a story that Max Lucado did in one of his books, a thing that happened to him as a young man, very interesting. And it said that he and three other college students were living in a houseboat that was anchored in the intercoastal waterway of Miami. And in 1979, Hurricane David plowed through the Caribbean and then passed over the Miami coastline. Knowing it was coming, the four young students tied their houseboat to the pier and got extra long rope and tied the houseboat to the trees on the land. Big, tall palm trees. The next day, we're quoting just from his book. The next day, an old fisherman who understood the sea and understood hurricanes saw what the boys had done and said to them, "You cannot save your houseboat by tying it to the pier on the trees. Piers get washed away in hurricanes and trees fall over." Then he said, "Your only hope is to anchor in the deep. Get yourselves 4 anchors," is what he said. "Then take your houseboat out into deep water and throw the anchors in 4 directions. Then you fellows row back to land, find a safe place to weather the storm, and when that hurricane comes through, you will be glad to see your houseboat made it through." That's a profound thought. Anchor deep and throw out 4 anchors. "That's your only hope," the man said. And guess what? It worked. What works for physical hurricanes works just as much for natural things and just as much for spiritual things and national heroes. Hurricanes. They work. Anchor deep, throw out 4 anchors. And we'll tell you what those anchors are. What are the 4 anchors? Now, I don't know about you, but I want to be, in this nation, we need an anchored church. Amen. I want to be that anchored church. I want this church to be the anchored church. Do you want it to be?
Yes.
I want to be the anchored church in the midst of the storm because we are in a storm.
Yes.
There is a huge storm. We're in it. It's not coming. We're in it. There is a huge storm going on, and I want to be the anchored church, one of the anchored churches that are in the middle of this storm. And we will ride this storm out, and we will be a place, a haven of rest. We'll be an ark for people to come in during the storm. So 4 anchors, 4 anchors. Let me tell you what those 4 anchors are. All right, number 1, the anchor of purpose. You're here for a purpose, and your purpose doesn't change in a storm.
Amen. Yes.
You are here for a purpose, and that purpose does not change because the storm is raging.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Losers focus on what they're going through. Champions focus on what they're going to.
Yes.
So my question is, where are you headed? Where are you headed? Hebrews 12 says, "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, disregard the shame." I read it to you. Now he's sitting in the place of honor beside God's throne. What enabled Jesus to face the cross? Do you understand? On the cross, our mind, we can't wrap ourselves around it. But on the cross, every sin of every person that has ever lived was put on him on that cross. Every sin. How did he do it? How did he bear it? So bad that God turned away his Father. How did he do it? That's why you and I don't have to bear it. He took it. I don't know how he did it, except that he knew what he was doing for his Father. If you and I, we can't. He came with a purpose. He came with a destiny to make it so we could go back to the Father. No one could have ever gone back home, so to speak. We came from heaven. We came from the heart of God. We all came from the heart of God. We could not have returned if Jesus had not made a way. We came with all this junk on our lives. We came bent down and sinners. And a way had to be so we could go back home. Whether you choose to go to heaven or not, listen to me. Whether you choose to go or not, from God's point of view, that's home.
Amen.
He wants you to come home.
Yes.
He's the Father waiting for the prodigal to return. Come home. He sent you here to choose him. He chose you before you came. And he wants you, when you came to this place called Earth, he doesn't want you to be a puppet. He wants you to choose to come back. But we couldn't even choose had Jesus not come. I mean, there wouldn't even be a path. Jesus is your path back home. Glory to God. Glory to God. And God loved his Father so much, he wanted to accomplish his purpose to set us free, give us a path back home, a clean path that we don't have to carry baggage. It's amazing. It's amazing. Listen, God's used sinners, he's used failures, but he cannot use quitters. You listen to me. He cannot use quitters. He cannot. You may think you're doing something without him. No, you are not. You are sinking fast. So drop the anchor of purpose. You need to talk to yourself. And you need to say, God put me on this earth for a purpose. I'm not going to talk about what I'm going through. I'm going to talk about what I'm going to. Glory to God. There's a great reward. There are crowns. I'm going back home. I'm going to my Father. Woo. Thank you, Jesus. Number two. Put the anchor of courage. Joshua was told 4 times to be courageous in the book of Joshua. Be courageous. Be courageous. Be courageous. Don't whine. Don't weaken. Don't wither. If God is for you, who can be against you? Courage is defined as the ability to finish the race even when you feel like you might be last place. But you keep on keeping on. Courage is forgiving a friend that you let down. I mean, that let you down. So courage is forgiving a friend that let you down. Courage is loving like you've never been hurt before. Courage is making the hard decisions, even when you know some people may not like it. Courage is keeping on, just keeping on. Courage is refusing to let adversity steal your smile because you know where you're going and you're not stuck where you are right now. Amen. Courage is trying again. Courage is dreaming again. Keep on dreaming. Courage is saying, I will not quit. Courage doesn't mean that you don't feel fear. Courage means you keep going despite the fear because you know where that fear comes from and you don't follow that nasty deceiver. He's a liar and he's a loser. So drop the anchor of courage. Number three, drop the anchor of worship. Paul knew all three of these. He knew all of them. He knew them. Drop the anchor of worship. We're not called to be a bunch of whiners. We're not called to be naysayers and doomsayers. We're not called to be that. Worship is what you do in the storm. I'm going to sing in the middle of the storm. I'm going to sing in the middle of the storm. Worship is what calms the storm inside of you. So when the storm outside is still raging, things are going on just unbelievably. Inside, when you worship, you'll have a peace down inside of you. Look at your neighbor and say, I need a peace. Worship. Yes. Praise him. Yes. Praise him. Yes. Praise him. Yes. The storm will not affect your destiny or your purpose. It's just a bump in the road. Yes. Glory to God. Number four, drop the anchor of fellowship. Now we need to listen up, okay? We need to drop this anchor of fellowship. Storms want to make you drift away from the church. I see it all the time. People, they go through something and they quit coming to church. And a lot of times they get mad with God. Now don't tell me they don't. I've been in this too long. They get mad with God. They stay away and they ho-hum and I don't know why this is happening to me. And you know what you usually want to say? I don't know why so-and-so happened to me either. But there's no need to go back. There's no need to compare happenings. But if you're anchored, I promise you, you can only drift so far until you feel the anchor pulling you back. Don't move from where you're being fed. Don't move from where security. Don't move where you're learning things you never learned when you were growing. Don't move. Today's your day. Today's your day to take your hope, throw it beyond the curtain, throw it beyond the veil, into the arms of Jesus Christ, where no storm can ever take it away from you. Christ alone, cornerstone. Weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He's Lord. He's Lord of all.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.
Are you well anchored? There is one point that has just been ringing home to me, and this was this. Losers focus on what they're going through. Winners focus on what they're going to. So you can't stay focused when storms come your way. You know who your anchor is. You stay and keep your eye on the prize. Losers just quit, they give up. But winners, they keep their eye on what that final prize is. Who are you today? Are you a loser? Are you a winner? I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. I'm gonna hear my praises roar. That's what you do. When the enemy and everything is coming in your mind of what is going on or what could happen, you have to sing louder than what those voices of discouragement are, and know that God is going to see you through every storm of your life.
Through the years, there have been many different phases of spiritual warfare taught in the church. The problem has been that most of these have been based on the things we thought we had to do in order to help God win. In essence, there was no sound biblical basis for our belief or actions. In the 4-CD series, Biblical Spiritual Warfare, Sandra brings clarification by teaching the biblical principles of spiritual warfare. Call and request offer 142 or order online.